without any further ado, we're very pleased this evening to have Chuck Hoberman, inventor of the Hoberman Sphere, to introduce tonight's speaker.
Hi, how's everyone tonight? Good, well, before I say anything, once a toy maker, always a toy maker. I have one slide. In the 1990s, I heard the great British mathematician and physicist Roger Penrose give a talk, and he showed this slide here, or something very much like it. It shows three things. It shows how people come from nature, but math comes from people, and that somehow nature is governed by the laws of math. So it's a kind of a circular paradox, which fascinates me. It's always fascinated me, and it's stayed with me ever since. Math embedded in man, man embedded in nature, and we look for borders, we look for boundaries, we look as close as we can, but they just seem to dissolve in front of us. And when I read and looked into the work of Carlo Séquin, and what he said is that he works at the boundary between art and mathematics. And it's that boundary which I think is something that's very close to my heart. And really the way that I'm able to understand his work, accessing it through the art. When I looked into his work, I was treated to a kind of a visual explosion of forms and colors and materials, pieces made from wire of casting and 3D printed materials. There's even like a fantastic, one of his giant sort of toroidal shapes that's made from a block of 10-foot cube of snow. And he goes through in this particular presentation the intricate carving of this piece. And the thing I loved about it was he didn't just show how it was carved, but there's this gleeful series of images as it dissolves as well. And I think I imagine it speaks to the way that he thinks about his work. Anyway, I'm not really qualified to speak about the mathematics that is going to be the subject of the lecture tonight, but anyone can see that the art is absolutely fantastic. And for me, I absolutely believe that art is a kind of a visceral, sensual way of accessing the thinking that goes in higher mathematics. Carlo Séquin has a doctorate in theoretical physics. He worked at the Institute of Applied Physics in Basel. He worked at Bell Labs. He is currently at the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science at Berkeley. There are so many terms in his papers and work, which every word is fantastic. I just don't know enough about it to really run through it. But I think he's going to bring us through some of it tonight. So let's give a round for Carlo Séquin. Thank you.
Well, Chuck, thank you very much for this very kind introduction. You may not know it, but actually, you're one of my secret heroes. You know, Chuck Hoberman, for those of you who don't know, he is the inventor of the Hoberman Sphere, which is one of these fabulous contraptions that expand and contract through a very cleverly conceived set of linkages. And there was a time early on when you could not buy those Hoberman spheres, you know, in completed assembly form in the store. The only thing you could buy was actually a kit. And I was probably an early adopter. I bought the kit, and in a better part of a day, together with my daughter, we assembled the kit, which had like 600 parts or something like that, and it actually worked. It still works. It hangs in my office. You can see it up there on the left. And at the bottom of the picture, you can see our two granddaughters visiting my office and already being fascinated by this wonderful contraption. And of course, I love this particular contraption. And next time I talk in my class about Moran's sphere inversion, and everybody goes, how can he possibly invert the sphere? I just do this, you know? And then they know, no sweat. So thank you very much for being willing to introduce me here. The talk is about art and mathematics and the relationship. That's kind of the core foundation. And a few years ago, we were very fortunate of having Dr. Ivan Sutherland as a visiting professor in our department. To computer graphics geeks, Ivan Sutherland is the father of computer graphics. You can see him on the left at MIT doing his PhD work on a program called Sketchpad, and that was an interactive contraption where with a light pen he was fiddling in front of a cathode ray tube and actually was painting a dynamic picture on that tube. At some point, he asked me, Carlo, what do you think? What came first, art or mathematics? I pondered the question for a while, and clearly there seems to be some very early art, some examples are shown here, that do not need any mathematics. They're kind of organic, free-form art. But not too much later, humans started to make regular periodic patterns. And then mathematics, in particular geometry, became very handy. So geometry may have served as a tool to make these patterns fit around a vase, or a basket, or maybe around a column, or a cupola. Anyhow, I fell in love with geometry in high school. In the 11th grade in Switzerland, we had a class called Darstellende Geometrie. In this country, I think the subject matter is called descriptive geometry. And with these wonderful constructions, and then we started to intersect cylinders and cones and so, I thought that was really cool stuff. I was really hooked. And from then on, whenever I had a chance in my job, you know, to kind of focus on the geometry, I used this opportunity. Fortunately, I had very many interesting assignments, and they all had an interesting geometry component. One of my first assignments after I finished my degree in physics, you know, typically go abroad for a couple of years, and I went to Bell Lab, and by dumb luck, I joined a group that had just invented charge-coupled devices. And so over several years, my assignments were to build ever bigger and better chips, basically solid-state image sensors using that principle. And at some point, and that's depicted here, the chips got big enough and had enough resolution so it was compatible with the American TV resolution. I'm happy to say that a couple of years ago, my bosses got the Nobel Prize for the invention of CCDs. And in the Nobel Prize report, you know, there's a big story about how important these things are for solid-state imaging and astronomy and the like, and they had a picture. And they actually showed that particular camera with my chip inside. So I felt pretty good having this as a first assignment and by luck falling into this group. The success of that actually then catapulted me to Berkeley, where together with Dave Patterson and our students, we built the first reduced instruction set computers that you see at the bottom there. And for a while, that was all the rage. You know, keep it simple, stupid, but make it really, really fast. And you can make just as good computers with that particular principle. So for about 10 years, I did layout of chips, and I created CAD tools to make layout easier and more automatic. And then it got a little boring, and we needed a new computer science building. And on top right, you can see Soda Hall, the home of computer science, and I got heavily involved, and it's amazing how much influence I actually had on this particular building. And a couple of brilliant students I had, they created the first interactive walkthrough through a building model, which at the time had 2 million polygons, and that was a lot in 1990 to create real-time interactive walkthrough. A little later, I teamed up with colleagues in mechanical engineering. We created some interesting linkages and mechanical parts and some frivolous things like this octagear. This is just a little toy that has 8 gear wheels interlocking, but not blocking each other. In the mid-90s, I started to collaborate with artist Brent Collins, and one of the results is the bronze sculpture that you see top left. It's called Pax Mundi, World Peace. And then more recently, I started to focus on math visualizations, such as the minimum energy Klein bottle, which you see up on top right, or the 4 regular maps on a genus 5 object, that's of a cube frame, as you see in the lower left. And just most recently, I designed the granite sculpture named Pillar of Engineering that you see in the lower right, and we just installed it a couple of months ago in our latest engineering building. So in all those design efforts, geometry was really, really important, but to make the result visually pleasing was also very important. So I would like to start my talk with the artistic side. And I would like to pay homage to Keizo Ushio. He is a Japanese sculptor, very well known in Japan, very well known in Australia, somewhat known in Europe, and almost unknown in this country. And I want to fix that. I first met Keizo Ushio at DESAMA 99. That is the conference of the International Society for Art, Mathematics, and Architecture. Previous to the conference, he had carved a sizable donut out of very hard granite. And then during the 4 days of the conference, he gradually drilled holes in the spiral patterns around this granite ring, you can see it here, which then magically separated the two pieces. And then the two pieces got rearranged into the position that you see on the right-hand side. And this configuration became Keizo's trademark. He later did a larger version of that, and that's so beautiful, I really want to show you how he did that. It's called the making of Oushi Zoke. Now, what on earth is that? What's an Oushi Zoke? Detectives out there? It's an anagram of his name. Right, anyhow, so how did he build that? Well, it all started in a quarry in Fukushima in Japan, where a really large stone slab was cut out and then on a flatbed truck moved to his studio. In the studio, it was subjected to a bandsaw and cut into a nice rectangular slab. The slab then was laid down flat, and now somebody had to drill a whole lot of holes along a circle and turn that slab into essentially this flat cylindrical wagon wheel. This wagon wheel was then put on a machine that had a high-powered water jet for carving under numerical computer control, and gradually it got transformed into this approximation to a torus. But then Keizo came in personally, and he refined the surface of a torus to this very fine textured surface. And on the right, you can see that he gets visited often by school children, and here's the particular celebration, celebrating essentially the completion of that donut. But it's only at that point where it gets really interesting, because now we have to apply this spiral cut. And a sequence of more than 100 holes very precisely placed around this spiral at exactly the right angle so it goes through the middle of the worm of this donut is applied. And the holes are very closely spaced, so it's then possible to essentially break the whole structure apart along this spiraling surface into two parts. And those two parts can then gradually be arranged. You can see on the left, it's just sort of coming apart, and on the right-hand side, it's put in that very interesting final position. In that position, it's then mounted on this large egg-shaped stone, which serves as the base. And when it's clear that everything fits and all the bolts are in the right place, then it is loaded on a flatbed truck and is transported to its final destination where it is installed. And I love this piece. I think it is a very intriguing geometry and it just shows exquisite craftsmanship in all the details. Now, this thing really intrigued me very much when I saw the principle for the first time in Isama 1999. So I went home and I had to find out just what exactly is going on. And the best way for me to find out what's going on is to make a model on a rapid prototyping machine. And I brought that very first model along, okay? So here is the donut shape, and then it has a spiral cut, and you kind of rearrange it. You can see there are these of two interlocking rings. And the inner and outer diameter are carefully chosen so that you get this very nice fit that you can see on the slide. What is really going on is that we can think of a blade going once around the donut ring, and in doing so, it twists through a full 360 degrees. And if you do that, you actually cut this bagel into two parts. Now, when I then talked about the analysis of that year or two later at the annual Bridges Art and Mathematics Conference, I jokingly suggested that this may be an interesting way of slicing a bagel. It offers some advantages. First of all, the top and bottom do not come apart. If you hold on to one, the other one cannot possibly fall on the floor. But also, the actual surface here, the spiral surface, has a slightly larger area than a plain cut through the bagel. And what does that mean? More cream cheese, you're right. So, George Hart actually took me up on this. And he has taught, you know, how to make these kind of bagel cuts, you know, at several workshops. He has also a beautiful homepage, of which I'm only showing two slides. He shows how to mark it up and then gives advice how to cut it without cutting your thumb. And most importantly, how to finish it and put the cream cheese on it. So I thought maybe that's an activity for tonight, but then I was thinking, you know, 300 bagels and all the cream cheese, I might get a little messy, and so we're going to do somewhat less tasty activities tonight. So let's go back to this structure again. I'm actually going to interpret that knife a little bit differently. Rather than thinking it of one straight knife that goes all the way through the worm, I'm thinking of it of a two-blade knife where the blades are attached to that yellow point in the middle. And the yellow point is traveling around the whole donut ring, and the two blades extending in opposite direction, they twist through 360 degrees. Now, why would I reinterpret it in that way? Well, I'm doing that so I can make a more complicated three-blade knife. Okay? And now we have this star-shaped knife. We do the same thing. We travel once around the donut, and we twist through a full 360 degrees. And what do you think will happen? Here is the bagel. The magic knife will take it apart and give you three interlocking rings. Now, this particular thing, I tried for a while. It doesn't really lend itself to make a particularly intriguing or a stupendous sculpture, but it makes a very nice little plaything. And so feel free after my talk to come and put and try to put this back together. You can also wiggle it and it almost folds back in itself. It's not very hard. Okay, but we need not stop at three blades, and we need not stop at a round cross-section. We can take a square cross-section, a four-blade knife, and we can cut, you know, the cross-section into these square strands. And that makes a puzzle that takes a little longer, okay? That doesn't just rattle together by negative entropy or something like that. And why stop at that? Because if you can solve that, I have another one for you. This one has six triangles that once formed a nice hexagonal cross-section, and I'm not sure whether we ever get it back together again in this original shape. In all those cases, the set of blades was rotating through a full 360 degrees, and that makes sure that one particular strand wraps around sort of the donut surface and comes back to itself and joins back to itself, and we actually get all of these interlocking rings. But there is another parameter, and Keizo Ushio has certainly made use of it. In all these sculptures, he uses just this straight knife, or as I would say, the two-blade knife, but he rotates by different amount. So in the middle, you see the structure we have discussed so far, the one that we also saw in San Sebastian at the Isama conference. But at left, he only twists that knife through 180 degrees. And now what happens? Now the two things do not fall apart. You now essentially get a semicircle cross-section that goes twice around the loop and then joins back to itself. And if you look on the right-hand side, if you twist the blade 540 degrees, then you still get that same cross-section, but now it turns three times while it goes once around the loop. Okay? In both cases, you essentially have still one solid piece of stone. So here is kind of a more formal description of what's going on here. We think of a knife that has B blades, and then we twist the knife through T times 360 degrees divided by B, because 360 over B, that essentially tells you what kind of a wedge you have. And then the parameter T tells you by how many wedges you kind of advance as you go once around the loop. And so as you plug in different numbers, you see the results. On the left there is the two-blade knife with one single 180-degree twist. And that's the Keizo sculpture that we saw on the left-hand side in the previous slide. In the middle, we essentially take a three-blade knife, and we gave it just a 120-degree twist, and that means that that 120-degree-shaped wedge goes around once, becomes its own neighbor, goes once around, essentially becomes the missing neighbor, goes around once more, and finally joins up with itself. Okay? And then on the right-hand side, we do the same thing, but now we say T equals 2, and we get basically the same structure, except just much more twisted. Okay. So the general result then says that all of these spiral cuts result in one or more so-called torus knots, and they can be possibly interlinked if there's more than one. They all form a T, B torus link, and each component is a T over G, B over G torus knot, where G is the greatest common divisor between T and B. I show here the special case for B equals 4, 4 blades, and the twist of 180 degree. And if we do that, we actually get two of these double loop things, but they're intertwined with one another. And at any one place, they're really sort of four strands in this particular bagel, as shown in the cross section on the lower right. All right, so that's how you can generalize, you know, from one simple sculpture and suddenly see a whole universe of possibilities evolve. And that's something I've done quite often. I started with the work that I liked one particular instance of a sculpture of one artist. I tried to find out what is the underlying geometry or mathematics. I tried to capture it in a program, and then I introduced half a dozen parameters, and I can make a whole family of additional sculptures that all kind of belong in the same family, but can be quite different and often are very much more complex than the original work. Okay, let's switch back to the artistic side and look at this structure from a different angle. Sculptors have known for a long time that the hollow, empty space in a sculpture is as important as its solid part. So let's focus on the space that we're cutting out. And to make that space a little bit more visible and more accessible, let's use a really thick knife to make a rather prominent cut in this bagel. And we used 180 degree twist for this example. In addition, I painted the inside of this sculpture in silver to make it really stand out and painted the outside dark so it recedes, so you focus on the inside. Now, I really would like to get a commission for building something like that, so at the, say, 30, 40 foot scale. Wouldn't it be fabulous to then be able to walk inside in this silvery mirrored surface? And of course, it has to be perfectly mirrored, sort of like the surfaces of Kapoor's sculpture, particularly, say, the Bean in Chicago. Now, imagine yourself standing in a concave space with this kind of optical quality and seeing yourself reflected again and again in this, you know, humongous twisting space. I think that would be an awesome experience. So Keizo was kind of intrigued, and around 2004, he also started to focus really on the space that he cut out. And in this particular beautiful example, he simply painted in a brilliant orange, you know, this inner space, so that your attention is drawn into that particular space. So let's look at that space a little bit more. Let's do a Gedanken experiment. If we could take all the particles that Keizo is drilling out and all the material that he removed from this particular bagel and put it back together exactly the way it was inside that sculpture, what kind of shape would we get? What is essentially the shape of the space if we can transfer it out separately and look at it? I hear a Möbius strip, and that's absolutely right, okay? This is a Möbius band. Now, for some of you who have not heard of Möbius band, a Möbius band can be seen as a closed ribbon with a 180-degree flip. That's just one instance of a Möbius band. For a more general mathematical definition, a Möbius band is a single-sided surface with a single edge. Single-sided means that even though it looks like a flat ribbon, you can start walking on one side, and as you go once around the Möbius band, you suddenly end up on the other side on that ribbon. So you can go from one side to the other without having to crawl over the edge. Okay? Now, Möbius bands can come in various different instantiations. And we're actually going to take a Möbius band and deform it. And we use some magic surface material which we allow to pass through itself. And that's what topologists do. You know, they assume there's a material where surfaces pass through one another without doing any harm. You cannot step from one surface branch to the other one, they can pass through one another. In addition, what we're going to demand is that you cannot make any sharp kinks, no creases, no cuts. It always has to be nice and smooth. Now let's look what happens to that Möbius band at left. If you analyze it very carefully, it's a little hard to see, but the way it crosses is so that as you go around, essentially it looks like you're making a 180-degree counterclockwise twist. Okay? Now we take this band, we don't cut it apart, we don't really structurally change anything on a local level. We just take what we had as a circular loop and we start to somewhat twist it, getting it closer and closer to figure eight. And by the time you're in the second image, we have sort of this loose open figure eight, and suddenly it does not look twisted anymore. At any point on that band when you stand, yes, it is bent, but you cannot say it's twisted to the right or to the left. So suddenly the twist has disappeared. And then we continue this warping until the sweep path of this Möbius strip is now truly a figure eight, a planar curve. And we can do that because we can allow the ribbon to pass through itself and self-intersect. Now we get figure three. And now if you analyze figure three and you try to see, okay, we're going around like that and it turns like that, suddenly you realize, whoa, now we have a 180-degree twist, but it goes clockwise. How is that possible? Well, it gets worse, because once you have crossed over this figure eight and you continue passing through itself and you open it up again into a roughly circular shape, as we see on the right-hand side, and now you look at the twist, and it suddenly seems like it has minus 540 degrees, or clockwise twist. So going from left to right, we have changed the twist of this ribbon magically by 720 degrees. Okay. That's a very deep physical principle, actually. And the Dirac belt trip relies on that. And so be careful when you try to measure the twist of a band that goes through space. You should first put it into a planar configuration, ideally circular. Then you know what real twist I've got. And the twist is ambiguous. It can go up or down by increments of 720 degrees. Now, artists have actually, I should point out, this kind of transformation, okay, that we're allowing here is called a regular homotopy. And so any two shapes that can be turned into one another by such a smooth deformation are said to be in the same regular homotopy class. This is the buzzword for tonight. So remember, regular homotopy. And then want to impress your friends, you know, in school tomorrow, whatever, that's the word, you know, to carry home. Artists have known about these Möbius bands, and almost all of these shapes have been used by some artist or other to make a sculpture. On the lower left, there's a wedding band that very much looks like the one above it, you know, that I found on the web. The second picture at the bottom is a famous sculpture by Max Bill, a famous Swiss sculptor. And the last two images come from M.C. Escher, and he has drawn this figure eight-like configuration, but also the triply twisted Möbius band, and he actually even split it, and we're gonna do that very quickly and very soon ourselves. Okay, one more step towards this fancy inner space. Now that we know we can twist the knife, you know, more than 180 degrees and still get the cohesive structure that holds together, I propose to make a sculpture where we twist the knife 540 degrees and we make it not only thick, but we make it concave to get even more of that inner space. And then you would get sort of a sculpture like that. And I'm very much looking for a commission to actually build that. In the background, you can see the Golden Gate, okay? So I get the feeling of the dimensions I have in mind here, okay? Well, here is a close-up of that thing, and it's only about that big, okay, made on a rapid prototyping machine. Okay, let's expand our scope a bit and ask, what if we started with something more intricate than just a bagel or a torus and then try to split that shape? What if we started with a Möbius band and then try to split that thing? Well, Keizo Ushio has actually done that more than 20 years ago. So overall, this structure is a relatively thick Möbius band with a rectangular cross-section. And again, you can see he's drilled out a whole lot of material and essentially made a longitudinal cut all the way around this Möbius band. Again, I think it's just a wonderful sculpture. It looks like it's made out of metal. It gleams so golden. It's actually stone. Okay? and it's photographed in the setting sun, and that gives it this really wonderful patina. Now, if we can split simple Möbius bands, we can also split, you know, triply twisted Möbius bands, as illustrated by a famous drawing by M.C. Escher. And to understand that better, I have created, you know, a couple of maquettes on our fused deposition modeling machine. And take a good look at that one, because in a few minutes you're trying to build this one, okay? So these are triply twisted Möbius band split down the middle. Again, Keizo Ushio has obviously known about these structures for quite a long time. I searched over his websites and I could find three different examples where he uses exactly that motif. Triply twisted Möbius band split down the middle. And all of them would be lovely sculptures I would love to have in my backyard. Again, with respect to an activity that comes up in about 2 minutes, there's another way we can split the Möbius band. So rather than splitting the band down the middle, we can try to foliate it. Okay? It's a little hard to actually do that with paper, so we're actually going to use two paper strips on top of one another to make us a model of that. And from the net address that you're seeing listed here, you can actually buy a metal ribbon that essentially forms this double-layered Möbius band. And it's a nice thing. You take it home and then snap, it suddenly opens up. And the real hard puzzle is to get it back together again. And you'll get a little bit of an experience of that. So, hands-on activities. I know there's quite a bit of difference in the background, how much you know about Möbius bands and who has already built these things. So I'm presenting three activities. The idea is not that you do all three of them. You find the one that is just right for you. You know, not too hard, not too simple. So you get something maximally efficient out of it. I'm going to describe all three activities with separate slides briefly. Pay attention so you get the details. And then I'll put up a summary of the three activities where you see all of them, and then you can go to the task. Okay, activity number one is for people who have not previously played with physical Möbius bands and never had the pleasure of actually cutting a Möbius bands apart. In this particular case, you will start with, you know, just a simple 11-inch long strip. You bend it into a loop, but before you join the ends, let me take a bigger thing so I can see it a little bit better. Before you join the ends, you make some kind of a flip, either 180 degree or an odd number of twists. You can also do three flips like that. To make it really interesting, what I recommend is before you do it, mark your paper strip with just a few arrows like that. Okay? And then, when several people build one of these Möbius strips on the table, compare them. See whether they're all exactly the same or whether they might be different. And if they are different, how many different versions of Möbius strips you get? By simply taking a paper strip, bending in a loop, and just making one flip. Of course, if you allow three, five, you know, and so on flips, then infinitely many. But just among those who took a single flip, are all the Möbius strips the same, or how many different ones can you expect? Now, once you have that, you may then take a marker pen, and you simply start marking a line here, scrolling through, maybe a quarter in from one of the edges. And you see where this line is going to end up and whether it ever comes back to itself again. Okay. Figure out what happens. And then last but not least, when you're all done, you make sort of a kink in your band. You make a little cut here with your scissors. So then you have a slot. You can get your scissor in there. And now you run your scissor along the whole Möbius strip all the way around until you come back where you started. And then you see what you got. You get two loops, are the loops intertwined or not, you know, or what else, okay? You get a corkscrew, whatever. Okay, figure that out. And by all these things, you know, work with your neighbors, get the expertise collected from the table, and get your expectations as much as you can from your neighbors. Number two, the double Möbius strip. In this case, you're taking two strips, and preferably you take the two colored strips. You put them on to one another so that the colors match. You know, violet to violet or brown to brown, it doesn't matter, okay? So now you have this double sandwich. You bend the double sandwich in a loop, bend it through just 180 degrees, okay? And then you need to put the ends together, but separately. Okay? So there are two layers here, and what you want to do is take the outer one and the inner one at that particular location and separately glue these two together and separately glue the other two together. Okay? If you glue everything together, there's not much fun that you can do with it. But if you glue them separately together, you should get something interesting. You want then convince you that they're really separate, so you put your finger or a pencil in there and you run it through that whole loop, okay? And convince yourself, yep, they're really separated. And then you kind of shake it a little bit and this stuff comes apart and you see what you get. And then you try to put it back together again. And interestingly enough, if you put brown on brown and you put it back together, are you forced to put together brown on brown? Or maybe can you put together purple on purple? An open problem. Okay, and finally, number three. We have this image on the left with this wonderful drawing of M.C. Escher, which I hand-colored with two different colors. And you're supposed to take, again, those two strips, but first you make a long strip of them, and you glue them together so that the colors match here. And then you just start forming it. You look at it. Okay, let's see. The thing that goes in the direction 10 o'clock. Yeah, okay, we start with something going off in the direction 10 o'clock. And then it forms forward over it, the dark side comes forward, and then it bends the other way. And so you try to visually match what you're bending to make that particular figure. And when you then succeed it, you might have, you know, something that may look something like that, okay? And you make sure all the over-under sequences on all the way it bends is exactly as in the drawing. And then you try to shuffle things a little bit and turn that particular structure you made into the structure that's on the far right. And here's the summary of the activities, and we can bring the house lights up, and now it's for you to dig in and pick one of those activities and get it to work. We're gonna cruise around the audience, and if you get stuck or something like that, we'll try to help. It's a loop. How much is it twisted? Well, that's one way. But if you now ask you, how much twist does the loop have overall?
And
purple. So here's brown on brown. So you get purple on purple. You really have to force at some point purple on purple and then work your way towards the end, I guess. That's a way to try to do it. That's tricky. Yes.
Could you explain what he's got here? What he does, you start with, number three.
See, nice and symmetrical, a three-way trefoil knot, okay?
I do have activity three there.
Yeah.
See it?
Yeah. Nice trefoil knot. We can see and compare whether each one of the flips is going the right way. It's going downwards,
yeah.
Downwards. This one is bending downwards. So this is great. Very nice.
I never
even saw that this existed, but this is beautiful, right? So, proof it can be done. And maybe she's selling the secret for a beer or two. Excellent. Okay, so that was only the beginning. We just started with humble little strips of paper and we split those. Now we're gonna split knots. Okay, but before we actually split knots, I want to point out that you have already created a knot when you split this triply twisted Mobius band. On top left, you see one of the instances of this Mobius band, and then gradually at the bottom, you can see how I took the rectangle cross-section, made it round, and more organically arranged the the cord of the knot. So it really is convincing that this is a trefoil knot. And on the lower right, I actually show the same knot with a square cross section, and we'll come back to that in a couple of slides. But before we do look at that one, we just take a thicker rectangular band. We form a trefoil knot, and then we split it down the middle. Okay. And what happens now if we split this one? Will it get two interlocking things, or will it be just one ribbon? Well, after the activity, you're probably quite clear. No, this is just one thing, because in a Möbius band, as you go once around through the whole knot, you come back, you're basically on the other rail. And so the two individual trefoils you get here, they're interlocking, they're forming just one thing, and that should make for a nice sculpture. And indeed, if rather than just having two square cross sections next to one another going along that split, if you change that cross section into something more organic, like two crescents that kind of face one another with their convex side, you get a pretty attractive sculpture already. The interesting thing about this sculpture is that it looks quite different if you look at it from the side. So from the top, you can really see the trefoil knot. If you look at it from the side, it sort of is more like an infinity symbol. At some point, I made a bigger sculpture out of that one, and I deliberately broke the symmetry. I made it sort of one lobe really large, one medium size, and one lower. It starts to look like a roller coaster. And it took great care to make sure the whole structure fit into a box of 10 feet by 10 feet by 12 feet tall. Now, why would I do that? Well, because that is the size of snow block that give you in Breckenridge, Colorado at the end of January in the snow sculpting competition. And five nerds of us were foolish enough to go there and try to attempt to build this particular sculpture. I have a little maquette here of it. Okay. And you'll understand the title now perfectly well. It's called Not Divided. Yes, of course, it does not really split the knot apart. It's just one double loop roller coaster. You have to go through every lobe twice in order to be back at the beginning where you started. And here's just a couple of pictures of how we did it. We actually built this twisted Möbius strip with a big, fat, rectangle cross-section first. And then we started digging into it and actually splitting it the whole length. And that's what you're seeing happening on the left picture. We just start the split on the right-hand side. We're pretty much done with the splitting, and you can see we're now starting to shape those squarish cross-section into this double crescent shape. It was a fun activity. But there are more ways to split a trefoil than just one. Here is this particularly nice trefoil that has a square cross-section, and it seems to have practically no twist. However, when you sketch in a cutting line on its surface, for instance, if you start at the red arrow on this outer lobe and you travel once around through the whole knot, you actually end up at the green dot, okay, 90 degree off to the side. And that means if you stuck a knife in perpendicular to the surface at the red arrow, you move it around, if you once go through the knot, you're now essentially horizontal in that particular branch. And if you continue to go once more through the whole knot, you basically have cut up that square cross-section into four small squares. And again, the question is, what happens to these individual strands? Well, they're all connected end to end. So basically, I've created one long loop that goes four times through the whole knot. And again, there's a model then that you can fiddle with at the end. And it's a little springy, but you can clearly see it's just one coherent structure. So now they're solidly in the domain of twisted prisms, no longer just, you know, paper strips. And now it gets interesting and more complicated, because an N-sided prism can be connected end to end in at least N different ways, where you connect different faces to one another. And of course, in addition, you could always add one more full turn of 360 degrees, and so you have infinitely many possibilities. But there's sort of N of them that are really substantially different, and so we focus on those. A particularly nice example of one of these twisted prisms is the sculpture by Hillman Ferguson called Umbilic Torus. He uses a three-sided prism. Now, it's not just a regular triangle. It's a hypocyclite. That means the faces are all kind of bent inwards. It's the kind of curve that you get if you roll a small circle on the inside of a large circle and you change, you select the radius just right, so you get like three of these pointed corners. You can see that cross-section on the top right. Now, in closing the loop, he took that cross-section and going around the torus, he rotated it by 120 degrees. Okay? So one of the faces going around becomes its neighboring face, goes around once more, becomes the third face, and goes back to it. So the whole surface of this sculpture is just one long rectangular strip that has essentially a concave profile. Now, in addition, you can see there's an interesting kind of marking on it. And this marking is a variant of the Hilbert curve. The Hilbert curve is a famous space-filling curve that you can sort of construct in a recursive manner. You start out with sort of a shape with three legs, and then you make full half-size copies at each one of the corners and connect them. Then you make 16 quarter-size copies, connect all of those, and you calculate the recurse as far as you like. And you can see the pattern nicely drawn on the pink surface here on the right. Now, what Hilbert actually did, he used that particular curve to guide the tip of a mill on a numerically controlled milling machine. And so this milling tip would go around in this curlicue manner, carefully controlled in space, and would mill out of high-density styrofoam a pattern that then was used as the mold to actually cast the bronze sculpture that you see in the form of the green ring. Okay. So I think this is a fabulous piece. I understand that out in Stony Brook at the Simon Center, they're going to build one that's 24 feet tall and is being assembled out of 144 individual plates, and they were all cast in sandstone, which was, again, essentially engraved with exactly the same trick, having a numerically controlled robot grinding out these Hilbert kind of curves out of this sandstone, which then serves as the mold in which you pour the bronze and you cast those panels. And it's in a state of assembly to be finished sometime later this fall. Here, I'm also using a three-sided prism, but this time I bent it into a trefoil knot. But now it's a three-sided prism forming that knot. And if we maintain perfect threefold symmetry and we do a three-way split, because, you know, a triangle splits most nicely into three equals part, then we get this structure on the right. And this particular structure has three interlocking trefoils. And unfortunately, I can build these only in one color, but on the computer you can see the yellow trefoil is the largest one, and then the red and the green are somewhat smaller. They're all by themselves perfectly symmetrical. Now, if I take this strand and I give the original three-sided prism an extra twist of 120 degrees, suddenly they start to all fuse together into a single structure again. Because now, once going around the loop, you end up on the neighboring position, connect to that one, go through the loop, go one over, and only after three passes like that are you back where you started. So now we have a coherent structure with a strand that goes three times through the full lobe. So here again is the other version where we had three separate trefoils of different size, but all perfectly symmetrical. Now, in this case, I take the bundle of three, and at the end, I take the whole bundle and twist it a full 360 degrees around and then reconnect. So everything gets reconnected again to what it was reconnected before. That means we still have three separate trefoils, but now the three trefoils are no longer threefold symmetrical. On the other hand, they're now all congruent. So now we have three identical parts that all interlock and form this overall braided trefoil. So these kind of structures raise another interesting question. They obviously seem to move against one another, and you can kind of rattle these trefoils after my talk, convince them they're all really separate. But just how much can they move? And can we design maybe the trefoil so they can move a little bit further? So I tried very hard to find a configuration that allows a substantial movement. And I worked with a simpler example first, one that only has two interlinking trefoils. And you can see here on the left with the blue arrow, that's kind of the cut that goes through the whole trefoil. And then the yellow arrow, they indicate just what operation you can do with that. That's seen from the top, so the two trefoils now twist by about 30 degrees, and so they open up to some degree. This is more interesting to look at from the side, so let's look at that sculpture. Here's the side view. And here it is, opened up, closed, open, closed, open. In order to do that, I had to be very careful on what geometry I really used, and I had to do, of course, a multiple of 360 degrees so that I would actually get two individual trefoils. But then I also had to make sure that they don't block one another. And the way that happens is that at the bottom, where the two strands touch the black pedestals, they're lying side to side so they can slide apart and open. But on top, where they cross over one another, I had to vertically stack them, because there they need to rotate and move and separate. So there we need a vertical stack. Well, once I figured out the principle, I wondered whether we can do the same thing with three strands. And you can see the same attempt at the bottom. The strands are next to one another, lying flat against the ground. But on top, where they cross over, we have a vertical stack of those three strands. And if you define everything very carefully and are careful with your geometry, yes, indeed, you can open the top loop, close it, open again, and you can also move the second loop in the intermediate position. Let's try twisting chains, okay? But the actual chains I'm interested in are sort of really very, very special chains. They look more like that, okay? They're kind of composed of holes and saddle surfaces, and they definitely have a very distinct prismatic structure. So they're not chains of individual interlocking links. They just kind of look like chains. And here is where it all started. It all started with a beautiful sculpture by Brent Collins called the Hyperbolic Hexagon. I found that in 94 in a paper, and I was immediately fascinated. I called up Brent Collins, and we had a 45-minute discussion on that first phone call, and that two-decade-long collaboration ensued. And here are some highlights of that collaboration. On the left, you see again this hyperbolic hexagon that started it all. And then on the right, you see our first two collaborative pieces that directly came out of this collaboration, were inspired by the structure on the left. You can see they're gradually more complicated. Now, what these structures have in common is that they all can be understood as either six or seven-story Shirk towers wound up into a loop. Let me explain. The key element in these sculptures is this sequence of holes and saddles stacked in the vertical direction along the z-axis. And they form a part of what is known as a minimal surface. That's the kind of shape that a soap film takes on. When you take a crooked wire, you dip in a basket with soap solution, pull it out, you get this nice balanced surface. That's a minimal surface because surface tensions try to pull this film in such a direction that the area gets minimized. Now, Mr. Shirk discovered a special such surface about 150 years ago that results when you have two planes crossing one another, and then you have tunnels going from the first quadrant into the third quadrant and from the second quadrant into the fourth quadrant, and you smooth everything out as here shown on the left. So that will be the standard Shirk minimal surface with having ordinaries of two-way saddles. Now, this structure extends to infinity in all directions. The four flanges become very planar, very boring, very quickly. In the vertical direction, this repetition always the same. So the only interesting structure artistically is really that central part, which I now show in the middle. I've cut out four of those stories. I've made them somewhat thicker to give them some physical structure. That's what I call a Shirk tower. And then importantly, this can be generalized. You can have more than just two planes intersecting in the z-axis. You can have three or four on the right-hand side. It's essentially a Shirk surface that has four planes and has correspondingly more complicated holes. So this central Shirk tower that I show on the left has ordinary biped saddle, you know, made for, say, human beings. And each saddle is just what you find on the back of the horse. But if we generalize it and we go to a structure with three planes, we would end up with something that's called a monkey saddle. And a monkey saddle has three valleys going down and three ridges in between. Why is that a monkey saddle? Monkey has a tail. Tail doesn't want to get squashed. So you need three grooves to accommodate two legs and one tail. Now, the fourth order saddle you might call a tiger saddle, because very often tigers say, hang up there in the tree, dangling all four limbs. So to be really comfortable up there on their branch, they need a tiger saddle or a fourth order saddle. But actually, monkey saddles are quite nice, and they make very artistic structures. Here, for instance, is of a virtual only, unfortunately, glass sculpture that has five stories of monkey saddles. Okay. Now, what I want to do is take this shirt tower and close it into a loop, perhaps even with a twist. Now, this particular structure has three hubs at the bottom, so three fingers sticking down, and then three more on top. So as we close this, we want to make sure we bring those ends nicely together to form one more perfect saddle. But as we do that, you know, we can obviously rotate them against one another. And that's the connection to the toroidal structure we have already looked at. So on the left again is this four-story simple Shirk tower, but this time it has a 180-degree twist. Now, if we did not give it a twist and just close it into a loop, you get the result seen on the top right. Okay, very symmetrical, kind of boring. But if you give it the twist that's shown on the left-hand side and then close it into a loop, you get what you see at the bottom. Okay? Less symmetrical, but I think much more dynamic and much more interesting. So this is the kind of stuff I was discussing with Brent Collins on that very first phone conversation. He says, oh my God, we can give it a twist, we can do this and that, because his hyperbolic hexagon had no twist in it. That would have been too hard for him to do without computers or without higher math. And he's a very intuitive guy that just sculpts nice saddle surfaces. But the other thing we came across in that first half hour was, look at that particular Shirk tower. On the bottom in the saddle, it's green. On the top in the saddle, it's green. You bring them together, you make a perfectly green hole. But now you add one more story to it. Say on top. You suddenly end up with a yellow saddle on top. Now we bring that yellow saddle on top in contact with the green saddle at the bottom, what do you get? You get a single-sided surface. Suddenly you get some kind of Möbius structure, because now we can cheaply go from yellow to green without having to step over the edges. And that's the hallmark of a single-sided surface. So we were thinking, wow, we can do these Möbius structures. And then what happens to the edges? If everything is straight, every edge connects back into itself. But as you start twisting it, you know, the first edge may go into the third edge and then into the fifth edge, and suddenly get all these toroidal structures and these torus knots intertwined, and you know, our minds were about to explode, and it was very hard to see all that talking on the telephone. So it takes Brent Collins about 3 months to create one of these sculptures, and it takes him even a week or two to make a model. So computers to the rescue. We had to study these things in a virtual domain. And so here's a small program I hacked together in the next couple of months called the Sculpture Generator 1. It can only do these twisted Chuck Collins toroidal structure. It can do nothing else, but it does that very well. With the sliders that you see here in this whole bank on the right-hand side, I can say what kind of saddles I want, how many of them I want, how much I'm going to stretch them, how much I'm going to twist the whole structure, how much I'm going to bend them, how thick the flanges are, how far they extend, you know, what's the outside. And very quickly, by moving these sliders around, I can make a whole lot of interesting looking structures. And then Brent Collins may say, ooh, I like the top left. And he may go off and then do one of those. But better yet, we can jointly decide what we want to do, maybe something like that. Okay? And in order to create that, well, we first set the parameters so everybody is happy with the result, what comes out of the sculpture generator. But then I use that same program to slice this wagon wheel horizontally in about 15 layers, 1 inch apart. I send all those blueprints to Brent Collins. He will take each plan, put them down on a 1 inch thick mahogany board, take the saber saw, cut it all out, and then he glues all of those pieces together. Now he has the overall structure right. Cannot mess up the symmetry. And now with his skills, he will make it very thin and graceful and smooth and polish it to perfection. And here is the structure we call the heptoroid, because this one has four saddles. It's single-sided because it's odd number of stories. It has four-way saddles, and there's a twist of, I think, about 3/4 of a turn all the way around. It was first exhibited at Fermi Lab in the Art Gallery in 1998, and those physicists loved it. They really saw different things in this structure. some people said, oh, it's just like the head of the drilling machine that bored the tunnel that we had to do for our accelerator. And I said, no. This is like the stellarator configuration that we use in our plasma experiments to confine, you know, the plasma stream. And then the theoreticians came and said, no, that's the structure of a quark. Then the astronomers come and said, no, that's the center of the galaxy. That's how the black hole is, and so on. You can see they had a lot of fun. All right, one more final thing we're going to twist. And this is twisting a self-intersecting surface. And the goal is to make a Klein bottle. Okay? So first, we form a figure eight tube. Okay? So basically, we have our rectangular domain. And every Klein bottle starts with a rectangular domain. And the rule is simply, you need to have two of these edges that join exactly the way they're drawn. And then the other two edges, they need to join just like you have in a Mobius band, essentially, with a twist. That's indicated on the left, where you can see the fundamental domain. Top and bottom have two green arrows going the same direction. Those we bring together. And then next, there are the two brown arrows in the vertical direction. They go in opposite direction. So in order to get them together, we have to do something funny. Okay? Now, in this particular case, we bring the top and bottom together, but we don't just make a round circular tube. No, we make a figure eight tube. We bend once up in front, we bend the other one in the back, and we essentially get this figure eight. Okay. Now, we want to close it so that the black numerical labels match. And you look at the drawing on the right, and there seems to be a problem, because on the left, the two is on top, the six is on the bottom. On the right, the six is on top, the two is on the bottom. And this is not going to work unless we give it a flip, right? We've done that with a paper strip. We can do it with this figure eight tube, okay? So we twist the whole thing. Now all the numbers nicely line up. We stuff them together, and we create this twisted figure eight ring. And the result is a Klein bottle. And in order to get you a better feeling of what it is to go inside this Klein bottle, let me see whether I can kick this one on. Yeah, okay. So we first start out by making a whole lot of these figure eight cross sections. We put them in a loop, but we actually twist them gradually. So in the end, they have done a 180-degree flip. The bluish lines are the longitudinal coordinates. And now we fly with our spaceship into the structure. We start in the bottom floor. We're cruising along through the lobe. Gradually, we work our way to the upper floor and get to the higher and higher stories, and out there we can look through the window in this somewhat cloudy universe on the outside. And that's what it's like to cruise through a Klein bottle. For a mathematician, what is a Klein bottle? Well, it's a single-sided surface. We know what that is. It has no edges or punctures. That's what's different from a Mobius band. The Mobius band always had that edge. Klein bottles have no edges. Okay? And critically, to make a real Klein bottle is that its Euler characteristic is zero. Now, the Euler characteristic is calculated by taking number of vertices minus number of edges plus number of faces. That has to balance. Now, what are these edges and vertices? Well, you remember we had all of those struts, and wherever two struts cross, you know, that's a vertex. Every segment of one of those struts is an edges. And every one of these little rectangular windows we have, that's one of the faces. And so you count all of them and you add it all up. You can convince yourself they balance. It is indeed a Klein bottle. We also say that this has genus too. You don't have to go into that. But most importantly, you cannot make a Klein bottle in our 3D Euclidean space that we live in without any self-intersections. All right. But then some of you say, wait a minute, I've seen Klein bottles, and that's not what they look like. Klein bottles look like that, okay? And indeed, that is the Klein bottle almost everybody that knows about Klein bottle knows first. And you have to look around a little bit to ever see the other Klein bottle. What I've done here, I've enhanced one of the ribbons that go through the mouth and through the handle with this train of normals that cruise around. And they should convince you this is single-sided. Because at some point, they point to the outside, they cruise through, and then they come back, and now suddenly they're on the inside. So clearly, there we have a Mobius strip. And actually, on the back side of this bottle, there's another Mobius strip. Keep that in mind, because I'm showing you these two Mobius strips a little bit later. Now, how does this relate to what we just did? Well, it's actually only a minor difference. We start with the same rectangular fundamental domain. We join again top and bottom edges, but this time we just make this ordinary tube that you see on the right. Now, we still have the problem of matching our labels, but look, we're in luck. 4 is always on top, 0 is always at the bottom, so maybe we can just close the ends. No, not so fast. On the left, the 2 is in front, the 6 is in the inside. On the right, the 6 is outside, the 2 is inside, so we cannot just bring them together. But we can take one end and slim it down. We can make the other end, blow it up, and then we stick the slim end into the thick end from the side. And now suddenly those two circles line up and all the labels match. Perfect. All we have to do is put a nice round end cap on it, and we have ourselves this classical bottle. It's the same domain, closed up with the same rules, but just using different twists through space to make these two different bottles. Here they are, side by side. Now, the interesting thing is you cannot transform one of these bottles into the other bottle. They're really separate. There's no regular homotopy, remember, that takes one into the other. They're in different regular homotopy classes. Okay, time for another activity. Hands-on experience with twisted prismatic toroids and making figure Klein bottles. Activity number 4, twisted prismatic toroids. That's where this one is coming in, okay? It's good to take blue dabs and essentially mark one of the 4 faces because marker pens don't really work on that. Once you've done it, you want to close it into a loop, but not like that, not in a boring loop where the blue matches the blue. Twist it by 90 degrees or by 180 degrees or by 270 degrees and then solidly kind of tape the end with the blue ribbon, with the blue masking tape, okay? And now you start tracing out what happened to this face. Obviously, at some point, it goes on the other side, and there was no blue there. So you make extra dabs, or you just use your finger. Figuring out, where is this face going? Is it joining itself again at some point? How many loops do you have to do? Do all the faces get marked in that particular process, okay? Discuss your results with your neighbors. Number 2, you're taking one of these, and that's a little bit hard to actually do this, but what we want to do is longitudinally make a figure 8 cross-section out of that. So what you need to do is essentially take 1/4 roughly and fold it to one side, and on the other side take 1/4, fold it the other side. So make this kind of a C shape. And now we assume, because we have magic material, that actually the ends of those two ridges that go towards the middle, they pass through and they form the figure 8 shape that you see on the far right on these drawings. Now, if we were to just kind of close this together like that, we would get a torus. It's a special torus. It's like a two-bulge bagel, okay? Not a Klein bottle. To make this a Klein bottle, we need to do this 180-degree twist. And when you do that, you will realize that at that junction, different colors come together. Okay? And that's the hallmark of a single-sided surface. Okay? So connect it in this particular way. Then you may want to take a marker pen, maybe run down one of these strips, see where it ends up, how many times you have to go around until you join back. Okay? Figure out why this is a Klein bottle. Make it clear in your head. And here is a summary of the activities. House lights up, please. And start to use your four-sided prism and your figure 8 tube to get some feeling about Klein bottles. It's good to take blue dabs and essentially mark one of the 4 faces. Once you've done it, you want to close it into a loop, twist it, and then solidly kind of tape the end with the blue ribbon. What we want to do is longitudinally make a figure 8 cross-section out of that. So what you need to do is essentially take 1/4 roughly and fold it to one side, and on the other side take 1/4, fold it the other side. So make this kind of a C shape, okay? And now we assume, because we have magic material, that actually the ends of those two ridges that go towards the middle, they pass through and they form the figure 8 shape. You now have enough motivation to continue with these investigations. Here again are the 2 Klein bottles. Note that they're quite different, okay? But in both cases, I was able to paint half of it with blue background and half of it with yellow background. And this for a very good reason, as is expressed in this limerick. A mathematician named Klein thought Möbius bands are divine. Said he, if you glue the edges of two, you'll get the weird bottle like mine. And what that really says is that every Klein bottle can be decomposed into two Möbius bands. And this is shown here graphically. On the left, you see the inverted sock Klein bottle. In the middle, you see the lower half shown in yellow. And if you kind of follow with your hand what it does, you can convince yourself this is a right-twisting Möbius strip. And then the upper half is flipped to the right, and you can see it's the mirror image of the yellow thing. So it's a left-twisting Möbius strip. And the same thing you can do for the twisted bottle. Basically, they have two Möbius strips, but both of them are of the same polarity. They're both left-twisting, or they're both right-twisting. And so what actually happens is there are really three structurally different Klein bottles, the inverted sock Klein bottle, and then two versions of that twisted figure eight Möbius strip you just did, the left-handed and the right-handed one. All of these three are different. None of them can be turned into the other one with a smooth transformation, so they're all in different regular homotopy classes. That's the deep mathematical insight. A little lighter note, okay, there's some very fancy Klein bottles. On the left, you see Cliff Stoll, one of the fabricators of Klein bottles. He probably holds what is the biggest Klein bottle that I know of in glass. On the right, there are two artworks by Alan Bennett, and they're exhibited in South Kensington in the Science Museum. And these three Klein bottles are all of the same type. They're all of the type as the one on the left, the inverted sock type, so they're in the same regular homotopy class. Now, Cliff Stoll also wrote the limerick, since you seem to like them. He said, mathematicians try hard to floor us with a non-orientable torus. The bottle of Klein, they say, is divine, but it's so exceedingly porous. Now, the work by Alec Bennett really inspired me to try to do some crazy Klein bottles myself, and since I'm interested in knots, I tried to make knotted Klein bottles. Okay? So here are some of these knotted Klein bottles. I call them knottles. They're not really bottles, they're not really knots, they're knottles. Okay? And all of these, you notice, they have an odd number of this inverting, surface inverting mouth, because if they had an even number, they would actually make some strange torus. Okay? And here it gets even weirder, because I also created some knottles that are based on the figure eight cross-section. You know, just making a loop is one way, but making actually a trefoil, you know, is another way of making a knotted Klein bottle out of figure eight. And then the middle one and the right one are even weirder, because they combine the principle of having this inversion mouth, you know, with the figure eight profile. And you can actually make real physical objects, real models. Some of them are displayed here. Come and explore them after my talk.